IVM.
Hi, everybody. Just wanted to ask everyone for a quick favor. We're running a brand survey right now and would really appreciate it if you could let us know what you think about the advertising on IVM. Go to ivmpodcast.com/survey and do let us know. As part of this, we'll be selecting 10 random participants and sending them some IVM swag. So do fill out those surveys.
Hi, and welcome to Noya Kalu. This is Amber from AM Rana Ventures, and welcome to another edition of our immigration special podcast with Mr. Evan Green and Tim Golden, who are both in a very senior position in our sister firm, which is Green and Spiegel. And they help, respectively, the practices of immigration for US and Canada. Evan heading Canada, I believe, and Tim being an expert at the American side of things. And we've had a brief conversation with both of them in our previous episode where we were comparing both the jurisdictions. Welcome, guys. Thank you so much again. And I hope you had a great time recording with us the first time. So continuing that journey, welcome. Welcome, Evan. Welcome, Tim. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thanks for having
us. Thank you for having us.
So I'm going to start again with the same conversation. It got left in between because we were having a paucity of time. But today also we'll keep it short. But I'll come again to this. Any new updates for our friends overseas and Asia and India specifically? Let's start with the American side of immigration. Do you see things changing with the pandemic changing? Tim, what would you have to say on that?
Yeah, I think obviously the immediate thing we go to is the consular section, which is the Department of State booking in visas. And we'll sort of talk the backside of USCIS after that. But Department of State is still under an emergency only requirement. NIEs, which is a very important aspect to entry from several countries, including India, which is the banned countries that have to do a 14-day quarantine outside of those countries, meaning direct travel into the United States is restricted from Iran, from China, from India, from Brazil, from South Africa. Cuba is also included in that listing. But obviously travel to the United States from Cuba is not. And of course, most importantly, Schengen area, UK and Ireland, as well as UK and Ireland. And because of that, those applications in those consular sectors are incredibly difficult because you go in for the visa and you also have to prove this standard of the NIE, which is an acronym for National Interest Exemption. And that's a waiver that's applied as you make the application. So walk you through just the basics. I have a brand new approved H-1B for my company. Never had a visa before. So I'm going to go and try to book in an appointment. In that system across the globe, they are booking really far out, most likely in 2022. And then the approach, and this is globally, the approach is I have an emergency. I'm going to make a request on my profile to push this up to a more convenient date. That's across the globe, as I mentioned. But in those countries that we mentioned, when you make that request, you also have to identify, oh, by the way, I'm also applying for an NIE. And that's sort of the position. And from that position, a lot of different consulates are taking on sort of different approaches. They're changing all the time. I don't want to say this across the board, but I would say that, Europe's getting maybe a little bit more accommodating in terms of considering them, but there are a lot of countries within Europe, so that unwinding. India, India is still at the same sort of position where it's got to be something that really speaks to sort of the global supply chain, certain sectors, and even in each individual consulate is really sort of focusing on those, whether it be manufacturing or agrarian concerns, et cetera. That's where the argument's got to come. And this individual and their role in the United States is so essential that they need this waiver to be granted. And that's sort of the key. And as I say, the specifics of each, Brazil's rolling out things that we're just trying to book in an appointment currently. And it's a sort of brand new setup for them, questionnaires in advance and sort of holding the application in suspension until you can sort of answer that NIE. But then other consulates across the world are still sort of granting it, and then you come in and make your argument. So all of them are dealing with a massive influx of requests for emergency appointments. And as a result, it's really unpredictable. And the confidence in getting that NIE, I would say, it is getting worse in some countries, getting better in some. Again, I don't want to make global assessments of those different countries, but I would say that Europe's in a better position, and then some of the others are really struggling.
No, and rightly put by you, because still a lot of Indians looking forward to invest and move to US, but I don't see anything moving for sure in the coming months altogether. And people are stuck out. Evan, you now over to you for Canada. I see Canada is a great, in a better position all over as far as, you know, immigrants coming in, students moving in from around the world. What would you have to say on that? I mean, what can one compare with the US?
It's interesting what's happened in Canada. Because what happened in Canada was our vaccine rollout was slower initially, but has really gained speed. And within Ontario, the largest province, I think the statistic is something like 82% now have one dose and 73% have two doses. So it's pretty good. Okay. So with that, obviously the rates have come down. And what the government has done is over the course of the summer, it's opened up travel in some respects. In July, at the beginning of July, it opened it up for people who were eligible to enter, didn't have to quarantine anymore for 14 days, as long as they were vaccinated. So it's all based on vaccine status. And in order to be considered vaccinated, it has to be an approved vaccine by the Canadian government. So that gives us Pfizer, Moderna, AstraZeneca, which is COVID Shield, and J&J, and 14 days from the last shot. If you have proof of that and you're eligible to enter, then you don't have to quarantine. So that was a big movement. On August 9th, we opened up to discretionary travel for American citizens and permanent residents living in the U.S. who, once again, are fully vaccinated. So if you're not vaccinated, you don't qualify for this. Hopefully, the numbers stay low, and they appear to be relatively low. On September 7th, we then open to the rest of the world. People will be eligible to enter if they hold a valid visa for discretionary travel, so business travel. But once again, you have to be vaccinated to qualify for this. And that's the real difference, I would say, to Canada, to the U.S. in this regard, is that in the U.S., being vaccinated became very political.
Right.
In Canada, it's not political. Okay. So the government said, we're open if you're vaccinated. You ain't vaccinated, you ain't coming in. And nobody's really bothering about that. So those have been the big changes over the course of the last little bit in terms of immigration. So hopefully by beginning of September, things continue as they will. We open up to people who are fully vaxxed, and it goes back to pre-pandemic. You don't have to quarantine if you're fully vaxxed, and you'll be able to travel. The requirement is you have to take a test. The PCR test has to be valid within 72 hours of your start of your travel. Now, with India, the nuance with India is there's no direct flights from India. They've right. canceled all direct flights. That's now been pushed to September 21st. And with that, you have to stop along the way, get another test, and then you can continue on. And so it's just a matter of you have to be able to enter that third country, get a test, and then you can continue on. And that's the nuance with the Indian nationals coming to Canada.
Right, because, you know, in fact, it's interesting because I was just talking to Stephen the other day that we've also got to fly. And now I believe they've told us that there's no direct flight. So I might have to fly, you know, via Dubai or, I don't know, some people have been flying to Mexico for some reason. And being
Mexico, stuck. Mexico has a good policy to let Indian nationals in.
But I think
that's why
I was quite shocked that you're flying to Mexico and then you're transiting. It's just again a whole drama there, right? So,
well, we become travel agents during the pandemic, right? You know, okay, yeah. You got to stop here, get a test here, right? Oh, you got the wrong test. We're not letting you in. The other news I would say is August 9th, the hotels went away. There are no longer COVID hotels in Canada.
That was the best part, right? Such a respite. But then the travel again became a headache. Now, I had some friends who complained saying that they had to go to Mexico, Some of them got ripped off in Mexico. Sorry, Mexico, on the podcast. But again, that happened and people got ripped off and then they were to fly back again. And some of the tests weren't recognized, which they did at the airport as well. I don't know what tests they did. So I think a whole lot of drama there. Tim, what were you saying? I'll have to come back to you because so many of Indian workers, especially in the IT sector, who've been looking to have draws and and move back, and you know, essential workers as well, whose lives have now just been stuck. I mean, I understand green card holders and citizens, for them it's much easier. But what do you have to say about this? Because Canada is going the right way.
Identify the parallel there, which is that this has been a strategy for US and entry because of that 14-day rule for quite some time, a 14-day respite in the Caribbean. Going to Mexico, where you can get that 14 days and then enter directly. Now, the stress on U.S. consular services in Mexico, where they would start entertaining third country nationals to come in, that's a bit of an ask. I mean, identifying that I've got an H-1B I-797 approval, and I'm going to try to set something up through the U.S. consular services in Mexico, that's a big request. But at the same time, to be able to sort of eliminate that 14-day restriction, that has been something that's been going on throughout the pandemic. And just to that 14 days, I mean, I think the real position from Europe, which is going to be the most complicated, is unraveling each one of those countries and their approaches, because that, I would say, was sort of the global, big hammer for a small nail, where they just said all of Europe and the Schengen area. And that, I think, is going to be the hardest to unravel.
It's so strict that if you're flying from India and stopping in Frankfurt, that stop in Frankfurt, ding, you're done.
Yep, exactly. And just to also piggyback on what Evan was saying about the Canadian side, the fact that Canada is opening up, that makes everything so much easier through the U.S. consular services here in Canada, meaning that they always are respectful for the local rules. So we had a lot of problems when Canada was on lockdown, when Canada didn't let anybody in for 14 days. That's where, because of the quarantine, you couldn't just sort of shoot up to the U.S. consular services here in Canada and use them, because it didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
But now that's being removed because Canada is not having that restriction anymore.
In fact, traveling to Europe has become more of a headache for everybody now, I would say. I would use the term headache because people have been trying to just get around. And the easiest way from India to enter North America is by Europe. Otherwise, it becomes altogether different. I mean, you know, even people trying to go through Dubai, Emirates has just hiked up the prices to a limit where it's not going to cost them so much to stay in a hotel than they would do flying one way to Canada. You know, I have people paying $7,000, $8,000 a flight just for a single passenger to get through. And that's costing as much as a 14-day quarantine at a hotel, I would say, or Airbnb, right? Do you see that changing, Tim? What do you think? Is US going to change the policy? Because a lot of the talent is pouring in Canada now, a lot of IT sectors putting in, I have the stats from the Canadian side that I assimilated in the past 3-4 months working with some of the counterparts at the embassy and meeting them. Now, it's quite shocking amount of Indians that are applying to move, actually. It's and everybody's preferring to move to Canada, being the friendlier nation to immigrate, you know.
I would, just in response, I would say that really is a something that I think in retrospect, you know, the idea was, well, Canada's fully shut down. But instead, the U.S. went through sort of an arbitrary system where, you know, it's raging in this country, so let's shut it down. But they've never developed any sort of metric as to when is it going to be okay. Obviously, it's going to be relevant to how many cases there are, what the vaccination rate, which is where Canada can take that position. If you're coming from any country, if you're vaccinated, that's fine. And again, Evan talks about sort of the political edge of that vaccination requirements from the United States and being able to enter. That's a tougher political issue to identify. But as I said, each individual country is going to have to be unraveled. I would say Europe is probably the closest, because that's another aspect in touching on what Evan said. You know, the U.S. raced out of the gate and then was sort of saying to everybody, oh, look how great we are with our vaxes, and then hit about, 60%, 70% in certain areas, but they're 50% in other areas. And I remember a phone call with a client just saying, oh, it's so awful to see what's happening to my native Canada on the call. And that was, right at the time when Canada was in another wave, et cetera. So then the change is, Everybody's able to come in, but now it's going to be the U.S. having to unravel whether it's France, whether it's the U.K., and what is that going to be? Is that going to be bilateral? Because you can't just sort of scoop it all up and say all Schengen area is covered, even though, you know, Europe has now surpassed the U.S. in terms of vaccination rates. That was over a month ago that they passed them. So, I mean, that's where it's going to come from. But at the same time, it's a difficult sort of bilateral discussion with each individual country to say, are you going to let our people in? And if you do, you know, what's that vaccination rate in the U.S.? So it's a complete turnaround in terms of perspective, I think.
And if I compare the jurisdictions, you know, I'll bring Australia also in because they're very touchy about their immigration laws, right? So many of them stuck here, the Aussies, and they're not letting the citizens back. And then when you compare the three jurisdictions, I see Canada on podium number one any day, and then Australia and is again nowhere. And you know, people have been reaching out to us shockingly saying, can I move from Australia to Canada? And that's something I would never expect, right, from people who are permanent residents because they have the permanent residency. But it's
shocking. Well, the thing that, yeah, I mean, you know, you think about it, Australia has been so locked down, right? We all understand why. But, you know, you have to apply as an Australian citizen for permission to leave Australia, which as a Canadian is just abhorrent to imagine that I have to apply to the government to leave my country. We don't believe in that. But it has to do with, I think that, you know, not seeing family for years and years, right? Like, you know, the pain and hardship that this is causing people and continues to cause people is remarkable, right? And there's certainly no movement in Australia in any way, shape, or form. If anything, it's going to get stricter before they open
it. And terrible numbers there for their percentages of vaccine. It's right. Just been a bad, bad rollout. And I think that's the ebbs and flows, as we talked about. You know, everybody, as I said, client was lamenting Canada and what restrictions were only a few months ago. And now, you know, soared past as Europe soared past the United States. And that's the big thing. I mean, it's about distribution of this vaccine and that country is going to receive you being comfortable with it.
No, and vaccination again, you know, now since most of the corporates are running for vaccination, but this work from home scenario again is affecting immigration to a very major, major front. There is a problem in India where the IT sector, as we talk, a lot of resources have been laid off. A lot of resources have been thought of as not being, you know, useful, and people from India would move to New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, where the IT was kind of picking up again and is picking up with startups and I would say different new innovations coming up all across. And even in US now, there's a huge downfall because of this COVID in these numbers, because the number of applicants going down as I would say international mobility happening. That's been a major, major thing. And similarly, you know, service industry again. But the upsurge part, again, I reiterate the upsurge part, you know, the number of applicants for work permits, forget the permanent residency, for work permits, you know, people who've studied in US or have studied in Canada, the ones who've studied in US are completely insecure. The way they see it is that if there's a window, they run away. They just totally fly in and no matter what. And I've seen it happening with, you know, my family and their friends who've been studying in the Ivy League colleges. Even they're scared that they don't know what's going to happen. In fact, I had a case where one of my friends working in a senior department somewhere in a big tech firm, actually, due to the draw of lots not happening for H-1B on those regular bases, and the one that happened clearly did not cover him, though he was in the senior manager category. So a lot of things happening in domestic front is also causing this upheaval between both the countries. But I still feel Canada is a little more preferential for a work.
Well, Canada during the pandemic, in terms of permanent status, Canada takes approximately now, the goal is about 400,000. And proportionately, it's approximately four times what the U.S. takes in terms of permanent residents. But they have spent an enormous amount of time trying to offer permanent residence to people who are already here. So the key part was getting a work permit and getting in the country. Because under the point system, the points have fallen dramatically over the course of the pandemic, but they're only drawing people who have a year of Canadian work experience. So that was the key, is getting in the country. So just as you said, it has to do with getting the work permit to get you in to sort of move your way through. And I mean, you know, a really good case scenario is, I mean, if you've got a U.S. educated person who gets a job in Canada, comes into the country, at 10 months, they're probably going to get drawn for permanent residence. And by 18 months, they are a permanent resident.
By 18 months, they are going to be
permanent
residents, which is a correct fact. Tim, I had a question for you on this, you know, investments. The EB-5 has been fluctuating again, and I saw a recent news flash that amounts have changed again for certain areas. But again, the no matter what the amount, but the waiting period.
And exactly,
yeah. It remains the same. So how is that lucrative? Stay making people buy those businesses. You're not letting them in. The families are something.
Yeah. That's, you know? I mean, that's what I want to talk about next was really sort of the grinding halt to USCIS, whether it's EB-5 or not. It's the processing of these cases. And also that sort of transition from an F-1 over to an H or F-1 through STEM. The employment authorization cards, I would say, is probably one of the most crippling aspects of this. I mean, across the board, whether it's you're an adjustment of status applicant, whether you are a student trying to get your I-765, it's just unpredictable. It's between, I would say, really in the area of like 6 to 12 months before you get it, which used to be a guarantee of 90 days, during the Obama administration. That was shut down during Trump. But, and there was, I think, a push after Biden came in. They flushed the system a little bit, but they just don't have the personnel to do it right now. And that's the really frustrating thing. At the same time, though, the silver lining or the things that we can look to be somewhat positive is that we're not mired in RFEs as much as we were. Every case that went in the previous administration, whether you had an H-1B or not, may have been RFE'd or denied. And premium processing, another that used to be, which is now a very significant fee of $2,500. But our success with premium processing has been pretty good in this new administration. They're not pushing back. It's not this obligatory, we got to throw our RFE with requesting everything in the kitchen sink at you to sort of justify the need. I think in some part, being within the United States or having that ability to sort of transition your status is very important because, so importantly, we've talked about the consulates are, still on lockdown pretty much.
No, and Tim, there's another question to this. You know, even though the Canadian consulate in India was not processing applications, I would say, in terms of international applications or Indian applications, I'd say, you know, the Indian diaspora couldn't move through, but they were still responsive enough to give you work permits, et cetera. Whereas the US was just completely shut. There was nothing happening for people from different areas wanting to move, I would say not on permanent green card basis, but others. And I've had some friends who've had rejections because it was very hastily done. And I don't see that opening up. I mean, as you said, politically, again, a jurisdiction change and so much happening all of a sudden. And now we can see it. I'm seeing things unfolding in Thailand as well, where a lot of people want to move from Thailand as well because the situation is getting bad there for COVID and politically as well. And there's going to be a mass immigration in Hong Kong again when people are wanting to move. And UK has been kind of incentivizing, saying that, hey, come to us, we are your brother colony and stuff like that. Whereas now, I mean, has got US something got to do with special status to such situations? Are those applications still allowed?
Of course. I mean, that's what we go to, is that emergency appointment. Can I get this NIE? I am critical to the infrastructure of the US. And as a result, unfortunately, that's what they're going to probably lean on for quite some time, maybe slowly sort of amend those or make it a little bit easier. But as I said, that's a country by country determination. I would say in Germany, it's easier to get an NIE at this point than it is to, make an application through São Paulo in Brazil. So, I mean, those are the things that it's a case by case basis. You've got to be able to identify, is this person, can we really make an argument that they are essential to the U.S. operations to be able to potentially overcome a 14-day restriction from a particular country, India, relevant to that. But even in, our local Canadian U.S. consular services, it's still emergency only, and we've gotten rejections from individuals who are Canadian and need to get an expedited appointment because they got one in, February 2022, and there's nothing else available.
Correct. Nevin, what do you have to say on that? Because I've seen a lot of refugees move around, and immigration is again picking up from Hong Kong, I would say it's huge. And probably sitting in Asia, I can predict something happening let's keep Afghanistan out right now, but something happening for sure on Thailand front as well, where I see a lot of businessmen planning to move overseas. And Canada seems to be welcoming people, if they have the right kind of resources, much more freely. I mean, I was interacting with a couple of people from Hong Kong, and they were very happy. I believe Greenwich Beagle had a huge office in Hong Kong, and so they remember the legacy as well, and you guys still operate pretty well there. And I heard people being very happy about the Canadian immigration system rather than preferring it to UK. They say we'll be happy to move to Canada.
Canada has a special Hong Kong program for people who went to school here. Right. There is a special program that is in place. You've raised Afghanistan. We're now inundated with requests from Afghanistan and how that's going to play out. And it's interesting. I was just before this meeting, I was on the phone with someone who was calling me about the exact Afghanistan situation and a highly qualified candidate. And the interesting thing is the only thing I can compare it to in terms of the refugee movement was Syria and how Canada dealt with Syria, because Canada did take, I think it was 55,000 Syrian refugees. And when that occurred, what happened was the government sent visa officers into Lebanon, which was then more stable than it is now, to process those cases. And what happened was, normally, in a refugee situation, a lot of times Canada in the past has taken the best and the brightest, okay? That's who they typically want. They want the highly educated English speakers, younger people. And in the Syrian situation, they did not do that, per se, because what they were looking for were people who were the lesser security risk. Because when that part of the world, security is a big, big issue. And I think we're going to have a similar situation in Afghanistan with security issues and how they're going to deal with that, because that's a big problem. Whole other kettle of fish there, right?
No, sure. And that's going to cause a lot of problem for any.
I mean, how do you get a security background check from somebody from Afghanistan? That is pretty hard to get.
It's as difficult as it could get. And I believe that's why U.S. is also not, Tim, nothing from the U.S. on the immigration front, because I have some listeners from Afghanistan as well in the Indian side working as students. I don't believe anything is happening on that front as well for Afghan refugees in
the
U.S.
Right? Oh, not the refugees. I mean, the refugees, the whole situation is a mess generally. But, you know, in terms of those numbers, I mean, they're stored somewhat the numbers overall. But that, I think, exactly what Evan's saying. It is always that backgrounder. And there is a long list of people who already are entitled and are statutorily entitled by the assistance that they provided over the last 20 years as translators, et cetera. And that is really bogged down. So that's where the focus area is going to be. Who helped us? Who can we help to get out? And that's going to be, you know, the immediate focus right now before there's any sort of general amnesty or anything like that from Afghanistan. Yeah. But at the same time, with the hideous, you know, scenes that we've seen of people clinging, you're hopeful that there's a pretty unified congressional effort that this was handled poorly. And can that be something that can be, which I think we spoke on the last podcast, there is not going to be some huge train of immigration coming down with all the bells and whistles. It's going to be isolated things like, you know, what can we do for Afghan refugees? What can we do with the H-1B program? What can we do with these, you know, other letters from the alphabet soup of classifications, rather than here we go, this is another big attempt like we tried in 2011. I don't see that happening, but at the same time, that's where we have to stay positive in terms of, getting small pieces done, because that's the only thing that really can be focused in on specifically, rather than politicizing and saying we're letting all the immigrants in.
Yes, I see Denmark also, even they have not given a very positive response. So they were the friendliest, but they're coming out with legislations that are not very proactive with this whole Afghan situation. And though a lot of Afghan refugees have landed in India as well. And I think when it comes to policies, I would say in terms of, residencies and how the programs are running, I have an interesting question for you guys. The permanent residency for Indian applicants in Canada has been smooth. It's been going on. It's only exterior people, you know, who are outside Canada where there was a slog. But Tim, what do you have to say about applicants for green cards who are within U.S. who are still waiting on the game to turn around? There's a huge backlog. Even people within U.S. are not getting the cards. So what is wrong with with the whole process there? Is it too stressed out, or
Is most definitely. I mean, right at the end of USCIS and the furlough that was going to go through, they finally saved them. But in reality, that was, big jobs, big numbers pushed back. You know, the funding's not there. They already had a backlog. As I said, they tried to sort of make an effort to push some of this stuff through, but they just can't. It is so, overwhelming with all of those applications where people are reacting like this. And I think that highlights what you're talking about is maybe, there was a process going on, whether it was employment-based or more likely sort of familial-based, is the shift to an adjustment of status. Everybody that's in the United States now is adjusting status within the United States. And that's a huge deluge on top of USCIS that's already underfunded and understaffed. So, I think that's that is a huge piece. But also I talked about the I-765, but right. The even more critical thing are the I-131s, the travel document that allows me to leave on my non-or visa that doesn't allow dual intent, despite the fact that my green card's here. Somebody who came in that circumstance. But I do think, something to highlight here, just in the interaction of, this discussion is that if Canada is easier to get to, if you can get a visa to Canada, if you can get permanent residence in Canada, then you're moving towards using the U.S. consular services in Canada, having more accessibility potentially into the United States and be able to, function in a cross-border capacity. Now, again, U.S. consular services here in Canada are still on an emergency basis only, but that exploration of the U.S., with a getting status here in Canada has been a practice for a long time, but I think it's even more prevalent and more relevant now that, all these restrictions going directly into the United States benefit.
Seems to be that, every country has its own mess, and travel, bottom line, travel's risky, right now.
Yeah.
Travel's risky. I was on the phone with somebody this morning and he was supposed to, he's Canadian, supposed to be going to the U.S. next week. And he goes, you have to take a test. You have to have that 72-hour test, right? So he goes, I got to plan my trip so I can come back in 72 hours. Because what happens if I'm in the U.S. and I test positive? I can't get back to Canada, right?
Canada, right? Absolutely. And that's a mess.
It's a mess. You're stuck there for 14 days minimum. So travel's risky these days.
No, but given that, in the whole hindsight, if you look at how things are, it seems Canada is coming out to be a savior for immigrants again, yet again, with policies and responses. There was a huge, huge outcry in Asia about nobody's responding during COVID and how Canada has come around and actually got the applications through. It's quite remarkable to see how they've done that. Whereas on the U.S. front, it still remains an arrogant front that, we'll be able to help you however we can, provided you fit the bill and you meet our requirements. So that still remains, the posture remains the same. There's no leeway, I would say, that has happened. But Canada has really tried to move around things in terms of helping people, at least have an answer to what's happening on their applications.
Well, some things, yes. We are seeing more and more movement, more and more movement. They're trying to have more of the applications put online, not paper-based applications, and that makes things go better. For sure, there's a movement in that direction because, listen, we've been at this now for 15 months, 16 months. We're in this situation. There has to be solutions here, right? And, we're going to have to learn to live with this, right? The new world that we're in. So let's hope things get better.
Yep. But I would just say, just in comparison to Canada, I've said this since I started working with Evan, Canadian immigration is a much more diversified, thoughtful and expansive platform. The U.S. is still working off the INA that was originated in the 50s. So it's either you got a familial relation or you got employment sponsorship and, a small sliver for significant investment into the United States. But outside of that, there has not been amendments. It's all just sort of working off that basic, 1950s framework.
No, correct. I've seen that. And that's what I think, because if you see in terms of business and opportunities, when you compare both the countries, the reason people now choose to be in Canada is as simple as that it is proximate to America. And then when they have the citizenship, it's easier to enter and get the American dream of working or moving there. But most of them choose to reside within Canada only because culturally there's, I would say, a bit of a difference, not much, but of course there's a difference. But again, people feel the borders are just porous enough to cross over and work if they can. And yeah, I mean, that works in favor of Canada always. And, you know, thanks to Green and Spiegel, I've been congratulating Stephen. I've been able to get my documents sorted, and hopefully I get to fly and see you guys in the next couple of months as well. But yeah, again,
just make sure you're vaccinated.
I'm double vaccinated.
Good. That's good. Okay.
And on the last note, I want to ask you this. Elections being called in, what can one predict for the immigration in Canada?
Well, I think that the general public view of the election is that they're wasting their time. Mm-hmm. Nobody really wants an election now. It was looked at as a political opportunity for Justin Trudeau to try and get another majority. And whether or not that happens or not, I don't know. But I think the general perception is it's a waste of time. We don't need this now. And it was politically his choice to do this. What that does is sort of everything stops from an immigration point of view. I mean, cases progress, but there's no changes, nothing. Everything has to stop immediately. And I know when people, it's very common, like in the US, you would call your senator's office to try to help you with a case. In Canada, you go to your MP's office to try and they can't help you now. Everything's sort of on hold till the September 20th date. So what is the election result going to be? I mean, I will tell you, I think that the result is not going to be very much different than it is today.
Well, that's great news. And I think for immigrants, you just got to sit by your pants and look out. And I think it's going to be great. And we hope to see you guys soon. And I'll be in Canada again, hopefully. And I'll see you guys. And thank you so much for being here today. Thanks a lot. And thanks. Have a great day to yourself, guys. Again, great insight.
Take care. Thank you.
Have a nice day.
Bye-bye.
Hey, it's been another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On This Round Is On Me, Shaili Chopra shares with Gauri how they hit 750 million on She The People TV. We have a new show, The Last Brand Standing. Anupam Gupta and Ambi Parmeshwar get together and discuss some of the biggest and most public feuds in Indian brand history. Do check that out. Taste the lip-smacking palate of Karachi with Bilal Hassan on Naan Curry with Sadaf and Archit. On Misconduct, learn all about Dawood Ibrahim's sister, Haseena Parker, with Raghvi and Nisha. Is the Indian Constitution queer-friendly? Find out on the Longest Constitution podcast with Priya Mirza. And on Audio Gyan, Harish S., design head at CRED, talks about his Carnatic rock band and design as an art form. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any other show for that matter, please do tell a friend. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors on the network this week, SEAT, CRED, Bank of Baroda, Quarter, CoinSwitch, Kuber, and Intuit India. Thank you so much for making this possible.
Are you looking for finance products and services that can enhance your personal finance experience? Are you looking for a space to talk about your financial product or service? And are you looking for a crisp talk show where the conversation is all about money? Well, your search ends here. Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta and I'm host of the Paisa Paisa podcast. And I invite you for the conversation about your personal finance on each Monday on the IVM podcast app or the website or on any podcast streaming platforms. See you, folks.